The Jen Weichel Show.
Thank you, Rob. We've got a studio full here. We got a jam-packed show coming up. It's Jen Weichel here. We are live. Give us a call. Shoot us a text. 312-591-8900. In studio right now, this is as good as it gets because it's like Chicago, but it's also paranormal. So it's my favorite combination. We have the Chicago Paranormal Investigators here, Dave Olson and Matt Perry, in studio with us. Matt, where are you? I can't see you. You're all over there. Okay, we got the screen in the way. I can't see you. Right. Because last time I interviewed Dave, you had a different person with you. So you got a team. You got a team of paranormal investigators. You go throughout the Chicago area, but also if you need to go to Wisconsin, you go wherever, Joliet, wherever they call you, they find you. They can find you at chicagoparanormal.com.
Exactly.
And Dave and Matt, you both have day jobs. Matt, you're a firefighter?
That's correct.
And Dave, you're a cop?
Yes.
Okay. Oh, how the heck did you get into the paranormal investigation scene? That's kind of a stretch.
Right. You know what? It all goes back to when I was younger. I had experiences that kind of opened my eyes to it.
Mm-hmm.
But as I got older, I mean, I still had experiences, but I became a little more skeptical, doubting myself. But maybe that's the cop in me. But I'm the type that needs to feel it, see it for myself. And 2008, I started buying some equipment. And I'm like, oh my God, there's something out there. You know, I got these recordings, EVP
voices. So you have cameras,
voices.
You have the EVPs, you have the audio, which is electronic voice phenomenon,
yes.
Right, for those who don't know. And the cameras are picking up on stuff, and on your website, on your YouTube, there's all this evidence that you've
got
mounting.
I got a lot of money invested in equipment.
Yeah.
Basically, everything's on TV.
Mm-hmm. And so, but the physical evidence, now you've told me this story before, and you didn't really think this was possible, but you walked into a haunted house, and you got attacked.
Yes.
Physically bleeding. Tell the listeners what happened.
It's actually a psychic medium that we deal with, Lori Ann. She's out of Appleton, Wisconsin.
Okay.
And she just moved into this house with her family about 6 months. And she knows there's spirits there because she gives readings and stuff, and sometimes spirits stick around. She's not worried about that. But she goes, Dave, there's something I truly believe that's never been human form before, and I'm not sure how I want to handle this case yet. And she handled so many cases of mine, helped families out, mm-hmm. Drove all the way to Chicago or via the phone and stuff. So I'm like, sure.
When you say help families out, you mean like people hear things going bump in the night and they want this woman to identify it, and then do you guys get rid of it?
Right. Well, okay. She'll teach them, or she'll come and help cleanse the location and tell them what to do themselves.
And there's a whole process for that, for the cleansing. We'll get to that in a minute. But first, back to when you were attacked.
So I'm like, sure, I'll come document it for you. And this was an eye-opener. I walk in there in 20 seconds. I got photos of it. I walk in there and something rips me open. I guess it felt that I was a threat.
So like a nail, a hand, claw? What was it?
Yeah, it looked like a finger.
Right.
For my left eye. I think it was my left eye. Mm-hmm. Down, ripped open my ear, and deep scratch down my neck. And then it attacked me again later that night.
That same day.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lane, for that awesome sound effect. Because seriously, that's frightening. You have physical evidence of something. And how about you, Matt? Have you ever had a physical reaction or something bad come your way on one of these investigations?
I've probably felt pushes, which is really kind of hard to verify. We were locked in a room. Mm-hmm. An investigation that the team was on, and Dave and I were in a electrical closet, basically, and we go to leave, and we can't open the door, being natural skeptical, wanting to find out what is wrong. I, like, basically did everything short of take the lock apart to try to figure out
why we're stuck,
and we tried it again, and I went there by myself. It's completely pitch dark, and we tried again, and same thing happens. I'm turning the knob, but the door won't open. Oh. And then within, I don't know, 30, 40 seconds, all of a sudden, it just opens up.
Okay.
But yeah, like.
Exactly.
You know, what's cool about it, we caught a full body apparition there.
You did?
Yes. One of the best photos I've ever captured, yes.
And what, male, female?
It looks male, you know, it looks like it almost has overalls.
Really?
It's listed on our website and.
Sure. ChicagoParanormal.com. If you're just tuning in, we are with the Chicago Paranormal Investigators, Dave Olson and Matt Perry. Dave Olson, a cop by day, paranormal investigator by night. Matt Perry, a firefighter by day, and investigator by night. And Matt, how did you get roped into this?
So I was out shaking the boot, like firemen do.
Yeah. Right.
Collecting for, I believe it was bird camp at the time. And right. Dave drives by with the this big blue ambulance with a cop shirt on. So I'm assuming he's like a special unit. So I ask him, you know, what he's doing. Right.
And because you have a huge mobile, Dave. Like,
yeah,
it's an entire ambulance. Yeah,
yeah,
it is.
So I just say, what are you working on, or what do you do? And he goes, well, I don't know if you believe it or not, but I'm a paranormal investigator. Mm-hmm. And at the time, yeah, I was really getting into watching all the shows, never really investigated, but... Mm-hmm. I sent Dave an email later that night. He got back to me right away, and I
stalked her.
Yeah, pretty much. within maybe 3 weeks or a month, something like that, I had the first case with him.
And, what was your first case?
It was a private residence in Elmwood Park, and I'm very skeptical, and a lot of my background is in construction, and I've been in thousands of homes. So my first thing I want to do is try to take it apart and see what it could be.
Which is very important.
Yeah.
Yeah, you should have somebody like that on your team. It's really important.
I'm very lucky, actually.
Yeah, you are. Hold on. 212-591-8900. Yeah, you are, he says. We got a special voice on the phone lines here. Susan Rowland, psychic medium Susan Rowland. Hey, Susan, your buddy Dave is here.
I know. Oh, hello.
Hey, Susan.
Hey, Susan.
How are you guys doing?
Good, very good.
So Susan joins the Chicago Paranormal Investigators on cases. And Susan, right before we got on the air, Dave was talking about a case that you guys did at the old Tribune Tower that's now under construction. Do you remember that haunting?
I remember it well, actually.
What happened?
It is a very haunted building. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so many employees there that work there at WGN have had many, many sightings. So they thought it would be a cool thing to have Dave and his team and the equipment and me. And it's kind of fun because, you know, we work really well together. We always have for years.
Yes.
But, you know, right, Dave, I just come in and I say, hey, there's a spirit right there. And Dave kind of gets his audio and his cameras and they get it.
They point and shoot where you say to go. Right?
Yeah, so, no, there's a lot of cases. She said, set your camera up here. She sees spirits in here.
That's where you're going to zoom in and they get all that footage.
And then, Dave said there was a cop or something. There was some sort of officer in the building at the old Tribune.
Yeah, you remember I wasn't feeling well? I mean, I wasn't nervous to go on the air or do the walkthrough, but it felt like something was draining my energy. And I finally said, hey, Susan, is there something around me? And we were in that waiting room at the time before going... doing our walk through the building, and he said, by the way, I was just going to tell you, there's a male spirit that was a police officer that's very intrigued and, you know, likes what you're doing.
Right, and I remember, I forgot the man's name, it's been so many years ago, but he actually told me his name. I think his name was Matt something, but he ended up being a police officer who also did video footage for WGN.
Wow.
And we had to Google it because we didn't recognize the name. For some reason, I can't remember the name offhand.
Right, but you guys were like right there, and then you found out that person.
Yes. People go, when I do clients, oh, you remember me? You had me, you know, 3 months ago. You remember me? I recognize the name.
Right.
But there's just so many stories, and there's so many messages that come through. It's hard to get it all straight and remember everything word by word. But it ended up that there was this gentleman who worked there. They found his name in a Google search, but they really had archive it and look. Mm-hmm. I just repeated the name that I kept hearing that Spirit was trying to let me know. And it was really an interesting thing. But, you know, Dave had captured so many things on footage at WGN, and we walked through everywhere, the whole building.
You know what was so cool is we were able to back that up, and which gives you credibility because...
thank you.
We backed... I asked him questions using the devices, the spirit box, ghost box, and we got a male voice coming through. Actually, first it was laughing, a male voice laughing at us. And then you told me, asked a question, asked how many years he was worked as the police. And I did, and he said, very long time, 30, and a few other things. And
mm-hmm.
And then you could verify how long he had actually worked there. But here's the question then, what do you do? So if somebody's listening right now, right, and they're like, oh, the Chicago Paranormal Investigators, cool. They go in and they document that there are actually spirits and ghosts trapped in houses. Then what do you do? What if you want them to leave? What if you don't want to keep them as a pet, right? That's when Susan comes in and Susan gets the equipment.
Well, then I clear them.
And you clear it. And so that's a process. There's sage, there's Palo Santo, there's all sorts of stuff that you use in your toolbox, Susan. So explain how it works.
Well, you know, I do sage, but sage is much different than getting a spirit to cross into the light. That's a whole different ritual that I do.
Okay.
And, you know, when I go to a home or a business and say the home is not doing well, you know, the children are afraid to go to sleep or, you know, parents are fighting, nothing is working in the house. You know, do you ever have that where one thing after another breaks down?
Right.
You know, it's one thing if, you know, you got to replace your furnace or this, but if the stove is breaking, the barbecue is breaking, you know, you have blah, 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 blah. All these things start breaking down. There's a lot of energy that's going into this house. So you have to clear it. But when I come in, I investigate the house. All I have to do is do a walkthrough. And I tell people, just give me a tour of your house and I will feel and I will see. And then all of a sudden, all of these spirits start manifesting and they come through. And I could tell you what the era is, what was there before the house was even built on the land.
Right.
And I can see all of these things that are coming through. So many times people think just because they have a brand new home that they're okay. It's the land. I always say, everybody, it's the land.
I agree.
Pay attention to the area.
Find out historically what happened before. Right.
Well, you know, there's a lot of places that have Indian reservations at one point.
Right. And Susan, you've gone into homes where there were actually murders and terrible things that happened, that families, that, you know, new owners come in and they don't know what happened beforehand, but something happened and the house was real.
She's an example, which she helped us out on, and this case means a lot to me.
Mm-hmm.
Not only did it help the living who was running the house, but
they were renting a house where something tragic had happened.
Right. And then Susan came and did her thing, which I'm very thankful for, and help the spirits move on.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not here to preach religion and everything, but after this case, it opened my eyes that I believe this is what happens. And it was that tragedy, I want to say 2013 in Downers Grove, where the whole family got murdered by the husband. And years later, this lady, it was a husband, wife, and a child, a little boy, rented the house, didn't know the background at all.
Mm-hmm.
And within the first month, things started happening, kind of bothering the boy, if I remember correctly, but not harming him, but I think letting the spirits there were showing themselves and kind of touching them and stuff like that.
Touching the child.
Yeah, and the child. Not harming him, but just maybe poking them and, and stuff, and hey, I'm here. And then, so she did research on the house, and like, oh my God, we just signed a lease on this house, and this is where all the murders happened. And I remember it was a...
And you're a cop. You're a paranormal investigator and you're an officer. So for, you know, the texter right now, Don, saying that this conversation is unethical. Well, it's factual. Sorry, Don. This is this happened. You're a cop, you're a police officer. You were called to this scene. And you, Matt, you're a firefighter, you know, and Susan, you guys team up to try to help people find harmony in their homes.
Right.
No, this is absolutely necessary, and it's happening all over the place. Just turn the travel channel. Every show now is haunted this and haunted that. So things are going bump in the night, and it's happening, and thankfully you guys are there to document it and help these, you know, help this get some healing. Help it find harmony. Right?
Yeah, so
what's really nice about what Dave and his team do, you have all the documentation. He's got the voices. He has all the footage. He has the video footage, and it's all there, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And it's not an orb. He actually catches the spirit. He catches what the spirit does, how it speaks. So it's all there. Whether you want to believe it or not, it's there. That's why I like what Dave does, because he captures all the proof. I capture all the history.
Right. But then there's also the whole thought of is if you do just think about what's scary, that you can bring in more fear and make it worse. So what about bringing in the light and cleansing the space and making it peaceful again? Is that possible?
It is, but you have to get the spirits to cross over. Those are what we call earthbound spirits, and there is no place for an earthbound spirit. So what do you do with them? Well, you have to actually, I talk to them, because many times, it's really interesting, but the spirit is lost. It doesn't know. The spirit is afraid to cross into that light. Now, you're going to say, well, why? Well, there's three reasons. One, they're afraid to cross into the light because maybe their passing was so fast. It's like they're in shock.
Right,
okay?
Right.
They didn't even know that they passed. Second, they want to leave loved ones with their family.
Right.
Okay? They don't want to do that. They feel so bad because the family's taking it so bad. And third, it's that you were murdered.
Right.
This is why I do a lot with murder investigations,
right,
cold case files, because they are not ready to cross over because they want to help and they want to get justice for what happened to them.
Right.
Many times I get the help from them. They're telling me, they're leading me, okay, what happened. And I go back and I time travel. So I'm at the murder scene. It's and you're, you know, it's almost like I'm the one who's invisible, but yet I see it all happening.
But you also, too, Susan, help out police officers to, you know, help with cold cases. And you donate your time, and you work with the officers, you work with the cops. Yeah. You don't take money for this, Dan, the firefighter who's texting us. You go and you donate your time to go and help, and you did this in May to the woman who was missing in Hawaii. Is that correct? And you helped them find her, and she was alive.
Yeah. I also found Madeline Connolly, who was missing in Montana with her dog, and they thought the bear ate her. They found bear trash. She was missing for 6 days.
Right.
And the family kept, you know, coming to me saying, could you help her? What do you see? We can't find her. Police can't find her. You know, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, okay, all right, I'll figure it out, you know. And yeah, you know, and a lot of times I'm working till, you know, 12, 2, 3 in the morning. I'm getting up at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, and then I'm starting my, you know, 13-14 hour day. So, you know, but it comes.
Right.
It just comes. I've got two missing people right now that I'm working at.
Right.
And I'm trying, but it's hard. How do you say no to that?
Right.
You know, I put yourself in, God forbid, if it was your child.
Absolutely.
That's what I always say. So, yes, you do.
You do.
But there's a lot that goes into that. But how do you not help somebody not have peace?
If you want to call and join the conversation, 312-591-8900. We've got the Chicago Paranormal Investigators in studio. Psychic medium Susan Rowland called in to say hello. You've worked with the Chicago Paranormal Investigators before. We're going to let you go, Susan, because I know you've got a million emails to respond to. But if people want to find you, SusanRowland.com. That's R-O-W-L-E-N.com. And we appreciate all you do to help people find peace and solve these cases and do what you do. So thank you, Susan, so much for calling us.
Thank you, Susan.
Thanks, Susan. Thanks for having me. So good to hear you guys. You know, keep up the great work here. You've got a lot more that you're going to be doing because people need you.
That's right. That's
the truth. Thanks,
we'll
always. Take care.
Okay, thank you so much, Susan. Yeah, we got questions coming up. We got texts coming through for our Chicago Paranormal Investigators. Again, Dave Olson and Matt Perry here in studio. They go all around and they find places that are haunted. That's right. They get the equipment. They document it. They don't slime you like the Ghostbusters did, but they do get the evidence. So don't go anywhere. This is the Jen Weigel Show.
The Jen Weigel Show.
On the Jen Weigel Show, we're here till midnight. Coming up, a really cool thing, we've got Dr. Amy Robbins, who is a clinical psychologist. She has been for 15 years, but a year ago just came out, not for being any certain gender and not for changing her sexuality. She came out for being a medium, so there's that. Anyway, so now we have the Chicago Paranormal Investigators, Dave Olson and Matt Perry. Matt Perry, also a firefighter by day, investigator at night. Dave Olson, a cop by day, investigator at night. And Dave and Matt, you say you're a huge skeptic. Dave, in the beginning, you were as well. You were kind of more curious than a believer of any of this.
Right. I mean, things when I was young, I at times heard disembodied voices and stuff like that. And finally admit it, I think I'm on a sensitive side. Not like a psychic medium, but...
No, but you have the ability to absorb. You're empathic. You can see when some people... That's probably what makes you a good cop. And same with you, Matt. I mean, I met a firefighter who told me he heard little whispers in his ear while he would fight a fire, turn left.
Really?
And then finally one night he would hear footsteps, and it was the captain that had died in a terrible fire. He showed himself and then disappeared. The guy emailed me after my first book, Stay Tuned, came out, and he was just horrified. He said, this goes against my faith. I said, well, why would your captain whispering in your ear to save your life in a fire go against your faith? I'm sorry, people, but angels are real. They are. The angels told Mary about Jesus coming back. Angels are real, and so are our loved ones that aren't quite on the other side yet. If they want to scratch Dave's face, which he talked about. I personally have been, I was in a haunted mansion. This was in East Dubuque, Iowa, and we were staying there. The family was all there, and I didn't do my research on the place. I was just like, oh, cool. It's an old, you know, everything's old in that area, kind of by the water. And it was horrifying. I was actually physically pinned down. And I was wide awake. I woke up. I saw this gray mist. I was pinned down. There was a bruise. When I woke up, there were bruises on my forearm. It was very real. And wow. I've never experienced anything like it, like you, Dave, when you got scratched in the face. So I came back so terrified. I'm like, I'm never going into a haunted again. You know, I think I called Susan Rowland, and she told me, look, Jen, you just got to protect yourself. And this is why people wear rosaries. People pray. If you go into an open, haunted, look at, there's Dave. He's got his rosary on right now. I'm a huge believer of that. I've got a Mother Mary necklace on right now. This is the deal. Everybody do your thing, but don't be ignorant about it, but also don't call it in. I am absolutely opposed to anything like a Ouija board or any of this time of year. The activity is ripe, and people like Susan are super busy, and you guys are too, I'm sure.
Yes.
Because the energies are, you know, they're kicking, aren't they?
Yeah.
You're getting
yeah.
a lot of calls, I bet.
Some crazy calls, but yeah, no. A lot of them legit.
Yeah. And so when you go, are you able to help these people find hope? I mean, I'm sure you are, but there are still some that are unsolved, aren't there?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, some people just want to make, you know, they want to know they're not going nuts. Mm-hmm. They want it documented. And then sometimes you go in there, just explain to them what might be going on or able to document it. You know, it most of the time it's nothing bad. You got to think of it was someone's grandmother, grandfather, child at one point. And, you know, it's just they're earthbound and haven't moved on.
You have a great sound on your website, chicagoparanormal.com. There's actually gunshots you can hear because this place used to be...
That's residual energy.
Yes, yeah. It's literally there. And it was picked up by your audio recording, like the EVP, right?
Right.
And so if you just have these things recorded, and there's so much science behind this, guys, anybody out there that's skeptical about the energy of audio getting picked up on recordings, it is so real. I mean, that had to have turned you a little bit, Matt, didn't it, when you have that evidence?
A lot of stuff that we caught is really
turned you into a believer?
Turned me into a believer, still skeptical. I want to do the research, and I want to know. I want to try to find out what it is before, or what it's not, before I say that it's something paranormal or... something like that. Like, I really want to try to dig
look
into
under
it.
The hood.
Look, exactly.
I'm not going to just take it for you can't take it as evidence right away. Mm-hmm. I mean, it takes me, before I put something out there, I go through everything. It takes me like 3 weeks, a month to go through everything. And you can ask them.
Yeah.
I'll go through every voice recorder we have. We might have 10 of them out there going for 8 to 10 hours. Every camera, the match and sync everything together. You know, the last thing you want to do is put out there, you know, anything false.
Absolutely.
I've listened to hours of the voice recorders, and it's hard to do.
It is. It takes a lot of patience to listen to the hours that you have,
goodness,
and then they put them on the site, chicagoparanormal.com. If you're just joining us, we're with the Chicago Paranormal Investigators. We'll hear more stories of their travels in just a minute. We've got to get some news and information. This is the Jen Weigel Show.
The Jen Weigel Show.
Just got a very funny text. It's the Jen Weigel Show, 312-591-8900. Jen, after listening to your interview with Ursula Vlasky about haunted Chicago, I don't think that anybody can go anywhere without seeing a ghost at any time. The paranormal investigators must be really busy. So there we have it. We are joined by the Chicago paranormal investigators. Dave Olson, cop by day, paranormal investigator by night. Matt Perry, firefighter by day and investigator by night. And we've got a ghost story on the line here. Becky wants to share her story, maybe for the investigators. Hey, Becky, welcome to WLS.
Thank you. You're not going to believe this, because even to this day, I still don't believe it. But
well, listen to her saying that sentence, too. I think you're in the right company. Go ahead.
A friend of ours was going to Arizona, and my husband and him worked together. And he asked us if we would go out and feed his horses while he was gone because he lived in the country. We said, yes, we would do it. So he left, and then we went out there. And when we were coming down the road to go turn into the lane to go up to the back, the attic light was lit upstairs. And I said, oh, he must have forgotten, left that on. But anyway, we went back, drove to the back, and my husband got out. And when he walked over to the where the trough was at to feed the horses, there's a pump there, and he had to turn the switch on it for the water to come up and go down. Okay, he walks over there, and just as he gets ready to turn the pump on, it came on by itself.
Yeah.
And he liked to turn Chuck White. Running back to the car, and he says to me, I never come out here again unless you're with me. It scared him to death. Well, the guy told us, you know, that in the attic, there was a pair of Civil War boots up there, the ones that came to your knee. Mm-hmm. Well, he just left them up there. He didn't take them down. Well, he sold the place, and a lady from Chicago bought it. She wanted to get out of Chicago. She came down, and she bought it. And she only lived there about a year, year and a half, and boom, she was gone.
Oh, dear.
Okay,
oh,
wow. So where he moved to, he said that he would go to bed at night, and he would hear somebody call him his name over him when he was in bed sleeping. He turned around and looked, and there was nobody there. And I told him, I said, a ghost will follow you. So I don't know if that thing followed him or what the deal was, but it was there. I seen it.
Becky, thank you so much for the call. That's really fascinating because just in the commercial break, I was talking to Matt Perry here, paranormal investigator, and his lovely wife, and they were saying that you went to Lincoln Park Zoo, which is super haunted, we found out from Ursula.
Very, very haunted.
Because they basically built over the old cemetery. They built over a burned cemetery after the Chicago fire because most of the headstones were wood.
Right.
And they just built, the barn is completely built over bodies.
Yes. Yeah.
And so you guys were at Lincoln Park Zoo and got a hitchhiker home?
Yeah. Well, okay. 10 to 13,000 bodies, I think, are still buried there. But yeah, we were doing the tours there for Halloween season, and somebody called my wife home and tried to for Ursula, correct? Yeah,
yes.
She got her hair pulled, and we were sitting next to each other, and I actually turned over and I saw the hair moving away from her head because she was looking at me to see if I was doing it. we had knocks on the walls. A fist punch against the wall over the headboard. So we talked to our psychic medium friend, Lorianne, who said that this was like a womanizing-type gangster guy that just wasn't happy that I was there.
Oh,
he
right.
Hung around for about 2 weeks.
He's trying to take your chick.
Yeah.
That's not cool.
The Cafe Brower there had...
Cafe Brower, yeah. It's like the Irish mob.
For sure. My gosh. So you guys have done all those places with all of your equipment for the paranormal investigators. You probably got a lot of sound, maybe some orbs, any images, anything from there?
At the zoo?
Yeah.
Yeah, we had a lot of voices at the barn, the farm area.
Yeah.
Cafe Brower, the ape house, and what's very haunted is the... Woman's bathroom in the Lion's House.
In the Lion's House, yeah.
That's why I have heard that. So the people say they see images in the mirrors.
Right.
You know, like, yes? Is that true?
When we were, we got early there. When we were first, I think it was our first night doing the tours.
Yeah.
We got there early and we're walking around and we wanted to, she had to go to the washroom and
your wife?
Yeah, my wife had to go to the washroom, sorry. And I was waiting upstairs and she goes, I hear her say, hello. And she thought I had come down there because it was empty. So it's like, she thought I was just being goofy and coming down there. And no, she actually saw a shadow behind her up against the, behind her. And then later on, Ursula showed us some pictures that actually had captured the same type of image that she saw.
Very interesting.
Yeah, it's a pretty wild place. I didn't expect as much from it.
But, from the zoo?
Yeah.
Especially because you're skeptical in the first place, Matt.
So cool, though. Well, it's not cool. I'll take that back. But not only have the bodies there, but you have the old bridge.
Mm-hmm.
Back in the day, it was four stories high, and it was well known to be a suicide bridge. There's even postcards you can find. It's the Chicago Suicide Bridge. So
at the turn of the century?
Yeah.
Or before that?
No, World's Fair.
Oh, okay, late 1800s.
So you could see the World's Fair from that bridge. It was, so high.
When it was four stories high.
Yes.
So I guess it was one way for them from the Lincoln Park area to cross over and then go to the horse and buggy carriage route.
Right.
You know, that was towards the Lakeshore Drive area.
Well, you know, there's also some really, I think, happy spirit stories. Like, they just love the house so much they don't want to leave. I went on an investigation once with a woman who was just like, we just renovated, you know, we spent all this money renovating, and I can see a woman, and she runs up and down the halls, and so she went and got somebody, and the woman was just like, I love it here, can't we share? You know, she didn't want to hurt anybody, she wasn't throwing toothbrushes or anything.
Yeah, there's no reason to get around, they just want to hang out.
I guess that would be up for negotiation, but I still think it's creepy, because, you know, Do Dead People Watch You Shower is the book by Concetta Bertoldi. It's a New York Times bestseller for a reason. She's on the show next week on Halloween, appropriately.
Oh.
And apparently they can't always watch your every move, but they are kind of looking over your shoulder sometimes.
I agree.
You know, you feel it too. So you talked about, I was asking Matt in the commercial break if there was ever a time that you were scared. You said you got the goosebumps, like the pricklies. I get goosebumps as a positive, but some people get like the chills as a negative. You're saying you felt some prickles when you were
there? Yeah, I mean, I've never really had a problem going in the dark spots when we're picking up the equipment. It just didn't bother me. Even after we got locked into that one room in the basement,
mm-hmm.
I went down there later and took about 3 cameras out of there by myself. But on another investigation, it was the Lake County Jail where Dillinger was held before he escaped. And
Crown Point, Indiana.
Crown Point, Indiana.
Oh, sure.
And it was a really, another, I can't think of his name, but a really bad guy that was also held on this one wing of the prison. Mm-hmm. And we were picking up, and I was grabbing, like, the last camera, and I'm walking down this dark hallway with all the jail cells, and I just got, like, the hair stood up on the back of my neck, and I'm just like, I am out of here, like Scooby-Doo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like,
yeah. Yeah, and that's really the only time I really felt anything like that, and I'm not as sensitive as Dave and some of the other team members.
So some of your other team members have reported things, Dave?
Yeah, they get the chills and the hair and arms standing up, and yeah.
Have anybody else gotten scratched like Dave got scratched that one time?
No, it seems that the only way he's picked on.
You poor thing. So now do you have a protocol? Like you say, you're wearing your rosary, you're good.
You know what? We try to, and sometimes we're guilty of not doing it because we're still tired. It's 4 or 5 in the morning, and we still got maybe 3-4 hour drive to go home.
Right.
So we're rushing, but we try to sage. After investigation, you know, whatever your beliefs are, sometimes we'll say protection prayers.
Yeah.
Sage everything ourselves, all the equipment, the vehicles we use. And we're fine. It's when we're in a rush and we don't do it. Sometimes things seem to follow us home.
You know what? I tell people it's like brushing your teeth. If you leave the house without brushing your teeth or you go to bed without brushing your teeth, you're going to notice, right? So I literally tell people that when I've interviewed so many different people with different skill sets and healers who claim to be this and psychics who claim to be that, but they all agree that if you walk around unconsciously, which means you aren't in prayer or you aren't in positive thinking or you're in negative sludge, right? And you're just walking through what could be a very haunted or dark area, right? It's like a lint roller going on that rug of somebody who has 4 cats. You will pick it all up. So imagine that lint roller is clean and then it goes over the rug and that's you and you don't even know what's happening and you're tired. You don't know why you're tired. And so that's why water is ceremonial. You know, use the tools that we have, prayer and water and, you know, some of the candles are good. Some people just believe in a white candle. This isn't because you're scared. It's because you want to create a sacred space. You want a clean space. You know, salt water is great for, you know, also spraying on old furniture. People don't realize that furniture has energies.
Oh, yeah.
People have haunted houses because of, you know, you get sea salt and water and you spray that on the antique grandfather clock. You might not hear it crackling at night. Have you guys experienced that in your paranormal investigation?
Yeah,
go ahead.
Oh, yeah. We have a neighbor who actually sees a old lady standing next to a piece of furniture that it was pretty old. I think it actually belonged to somebody in their family.
Mm-hmm.
But he only sees it if he's walking past a mirror and he sees the reflection of a woman standing next to this old piece of furniture.
Interesting.
So, yeah.
Yeah, I'm like, I'm hearing a disembodied voice right now. No.
Good thing we had it on camera. Yeah.
There's a case we handled. It took a while to put things together, but this lady would see a male subject lean against this fake fireplace. It was like a piece of art.
Uh-huh.
But she found it on the roadside, curbside, mm-hmm. took it home. She was an artist herself, fixed it up really nice and brought it to her house. And then she didn't put two and two together, but this male spirit seemed to be attached to that fireplace. I was leaning against it, then walked down the hallway and would stand over her bed and watch her and then back to the fireplace. So during the investigation, we figured out it's got to be this...
piece of furniture.
Yeah, and it turned out with some research and stuff that the guy who made it ended up committing suicide, and this was his favorite piece, and his energy was attached to it.
Just very attached.
So once we got rid of it...
Everything was gone.
Everything was gone.
Oh, see, that's huge. And again, I can't stress this enough. I'm so anti-Ouija board. I think it's just basically a calling card to ask board spirits to come show off. It is.
I've never used one.
It is really bad. I've been on investigations. I actually met a priest who said he was called to a house because, and they found out the teenager had been using a Ouija board. They found it under her bed. And as soon as they got rid, they actually threw it out. They came back to the house the next day. It was on the table.
No.
It was on the table. The priest.
That was in a movie.
No, that was the priest. And if a man of the cloth hadn't told me that, I wouldn't have believed it. I'm telling you, Matt. It was like, wait, what? So then, those stories have happened. But I also went on an investigation with a family. They had been having a lot of, they kept seeing a man that looked like a butler, you know, in an old kind of turn of the century sort of, you know, man walking through with a tray. And they didn't feel that it was a mean spirit. It was just kind of like, what's that? You know, they would see it out of the corner of their eye. And it started happening when this certain clock came in. So they got somebody that came in, like a Susan Roland, but this was actually out in the East Coast.
Okay.
And so they got this person. She came in and she said, oh, this is he used to be the butler of the house, and he's attached to that clock. And she didn't know that they had just gotten that clock. So they decided to keep the clock, and they kept the butler. They're like, hey, he's cool.
As long as he's doing the shit, right?
There. Yeah, he's not scared anybody.
With the whole Ouija board thing, it really depends on, like, the person's intention. Because, I mean, we don't use Ouija boards, but in effect, what we're trying to do is actually communicate, which is kind of the same thing.
Right.
Well,
yeah. We're using different types of
But you're
medium,
not going in there and saying...
We're not going in there like we want
to... Anybody want to talk to us? I mean, are you saying that? Because
no.
If you say if there's any energy that wants to talk to us, we've got the equipment. And I see that on some of the shows. Again, bad, bad, bad idea, because that's asking the dark and the light.
Right.
You have to really set an intention for the light. And so I guess you're right, Matt. If somebody's got their Ouija board and they're all about, you know, love and angels, and they've got their Mother Mary and their Jesus statue, and I just can't imagine that that would be something that somebody would combo platter together, but maybe they would. But if you walk into anywhere and you've got your recorder on and you're like, I only want you just talk to me, anybody, anything, what do you got? That's when you're basically any board spirit. You're going to open up to madness.
Right.
You don't want to. That's right. Well, what's on the docket for next week with Halloween? You guys might be booked, yeah?
Yeah, you know what?
You think?
We actually have a lot of podcasts coming up. We got to do actually one tomorrow morning again. Mm-hmm. And then... the Halloween itself, I'm left open for my family.
Good.
Yeah.
Good for you, because you are a dad.
Yes.
And you have to do that. How about you, Matt?
Same thing.
Same thing. So 6 years into this, do you regret getting involved with Dave and the Paranormal Society?
No, I've really seen some stuff that opened my eyes, and it's we've had a lot of fun.
Uh-huh.
I've seen a lot of different places, and no, I don't regret it at all.
If anybody has a question for Dave and the Chicago Paranormal Investigators, they can go to chicagoparanormal.com. Is that correct, Dave?
Yes, yes, it is.
And if they email you from there, also they can go on the YouTube and they can hear, they can see, they can watch. I was going to pull up one of the videos and put it on the microphone here, but it's just not as good audio. Just tell people to go to the YouTube for Chicago Paranormal Investigators or to chicagoparanormal.com. Don't call them on Halloween. They're going to be with their families.
And we're taking a day off
as well as they should.
Facebook and Twitter as well.
Okay, so Facebook and Twitter as well. And just put out the positive light, everybody. You know, and sometimes you can't always figure it out. You need somebody to help you fill in the blanks. I always say... everybody needs somebody to tell them when they've got basil in their teeth, right?
That's correct.
You can't see everything.
One thing's important and people don't realize, and like I said, I'm not here to preach, mm-hmm. but some people think they can sage once and, you
That's
know,
it
will solve everything.
No.
You know, sometimes that could work for a day, a week, a month, depending on the energy and what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know.
Yeah. Do it every day.
Multiple times.
A couple times a day. 2-3 times. It's like what I said, brushing your teeth. Come on, morning and night. Just remember that, people.
Both?
Yes, both.
Oh.
Hello. This is the Jen Weigel Show. Don't go anywhere.
The Jen Weigel Show.
Coming up on the top of the hour of the Jen Weigel Show, Scott, we're going to answer your question for you because we're coming up against the news. Thank you for calling in at 312-591-8900. Scott wants to know if evil past events, not necessarily a murder, can leave a bad energy. So what do you guys think, Dave?
I would say so. Yeah. Just think of all the negativity, all the badness that happened in prisons and stuff. And
yes, but they leave an imprint.
Yes. The energy doesn't go away. The energy just sits there like a mist. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was in a bar once, and, you know, there was just this real icky, dark, gray feeling, and it, apparently that's where he used to punish all of his employees. He didn't kill anybody. He would just beat them up.
Oh,
so,
boy.
Yeah, good times.
Yeah.
I had more for that guy. All right, so coming up, we've got Dr. Amy Robbins. Pretty cool. She's a clinical psychologist for 15 years, and just last year she came out as being a medium as well. This is all Halloween-themed, by the way.